thank you, Doctor. Good evening. I just wanted to ring up to say you'll have to be looking for another bridge partner, I'm afraid. I'm going away. Yes, I want to go to Amsterdam. I have friends there. No, plural, believe it or not. Who will you get for a fourth? We have a play for a fortnight. Oh, that's right. That's right. Fritz had a cold, too. Well, it's absurd to go on playing a bridge when it's as cold as it is, I always say. Yes. Oh. But no, Doctor, how could I anyway? Tekla had her mother there. Yes, I know. Put that idea into my head. I just kept putting it off, but you know, now I really got... Right. We'll have to cancel our cinema date. Remember me to Tekla. Yes. Well, au revoir. Of course I will. Goodbye. This is Judith Keith. Can I speak to Frau, please? Latte, I just wanted to say goodbye. I'm going away for a bit. No, nothing's wrong. I just want to see some new faces. What I really need to say is Fritz is having the professor here on Tuesday evening, and I wondered if you both might come too. I'm off tonight, as I said. Yes. Tuesday, that's it. No, there's no... No, I just wanted you to know that I'm off tonight. There's no connection. I just thought you might be able to come then. Well, shall we say, even though I shan't be there? Yes. Of course I know you're not that sort. But what about it? These are such unsettled times, and everyone's being so careful, you know? So you'll come? It depends on Max. Well, he'll manage it. The professor's coming, tell him. Well, listen, I must ring off now. Goodbye, then. Is that you, Gertrude? It's Judith. I'm sorry to be disturbing you, but, thanks. I wanted to ask if you could see that Fritz is all right. I'm going away for a few months. Well, being his sister, I thought you... Why not? Well, no, nobody would think that. Anyway, not Fritz. Well, of course, he knows we don't get on all that well, but... Then he can simply call you if you prefer it that way. Yes, I'll tell him that. Listen, everything's fairly straight. The flat is on the big side. I would leave his workroom for Ida to deal with. She knows what's to be done. Yes, well, I find her pretty intelligent, and he's used to her, so... Oh, and there's another thing. I hope you don't mind my saying so, but... He doesn't like talking before meals. Can you remember that? I always used to watch myself. No, I really don't want to argue about that just now. It's not long till my train goes, and I haven't finished packing, you know? So keep an eye on his suits, please. And remind him to go to the tailor. He's ordered a new overcoat. And do see that his bedroom is properly heated. He likes to sleep with the window open, and it's too cold, you know? So, yes, well, no, Listen, I must ring off now. Yes, I am. I am very grateful to you, Gertrude. We'll write to each other now, won't we? Goodbye, then. Anna, it's Judith. Look, I'm just off. No, there's no way out. Things are getting too difficult. Oh, no, it isn't Fritz's idea. He doesn't even know yet. I simply packed my things. I don't think so. I don't think he'll say all that much. It's all got too difficult for him, just in everyday matters. Well, that's something we just haven't arranged yet. We just never talk about it. Yes, well, I'd be grateful if you would especially on Sundays, and try to make him give up this flat. It's too big for him. I know I would like to have come and said goodbye to you, but it's your quarter, So goodbye. And no, don't come to the station. It's a bad idea. Goodbye, Anna. I'll write to you. That's a promise. I'm off. I suppose I've waited too long. No, I'm awfully sorry, but... Fritz, you must let me go. You can't keep me here. I'll be your downfall, that's quite clear. No, I know you're not a coward. You're not afraid of the police, but there are worse things. They won't put you in a camp, but they'll ban you from the clinic any day now. We won't say anything at first, but it will make you ill. I'm not going to watch you sit around in this flat pretending to read magazines all day. It's pure selfishness on my part, my leaving, that's all. No, don't say anything. Don't tell me you haven't changed. Why, only last week you established quite objectively that the proportion of Jewish scientists isn't all that high. Objectivity is always the start of it. Why do you keep telling me? I've never been such a jerk chauvinist as now. Of course I am. Chauvinism is catching. What's happened to us? Done for a long time because I can't talk when I'm looking at Fritz. So it seems to me there's no point in talking, really. It's all been settled already. What's they really want. What have I ever done to them? Did I have anything to do with politics? Did I ever vote communist? But I'm just some bourgeois housewife with servants and so on. And now all of a sudden, it seems only blondes can be that. You know, I've often thought lately about something you said to me years back. How some people are more valuable than others. And so one lot were given insulin when they got diabetes and the others weren't. That's something I understood in it that I was. Now it seems they made a new distinction of the same sort. Only this time, I'm one of the less valuable ones. Serves me right. Yes. Yes, I'm packing. And don't pretend you haven't noticed anything in the last few weeks. Nothing really matters, Fritz, except one thing. We spend our last hour together without looking at each other's eyes. That's a triumph. They can't be allowed, the liars who force everyone else to lie. 10 years ago, when somebody said no one would think I was Jewish, you instantly said, yes, they would. That's fine. That's straightforward. Why go about it in a roundabout way now? I'm packing. So they shan't take away your job as senior physician. Because they stopped saying good morning to you at the clinic and because you're not sleeping nowadays. I don't want you to tell me I mustn't go. And I'm hurrying to leave because I don't want to hear you tell me that I must. It's a matter of time. Principles with you is a matter of time. They don't last any longer than a glove does. Oh, a good one lasts a long while, but even they only have a certain life. Don't get the idea that I'm angry. Yes, I am! Why should I always be understanding? What's wrong with the shape of my nose and the color of my hair? I'm to leave the town I was born in so they shan't go short on butter? Oh, what kind of people are you? You're self-included. You work out the quantum theory and the Trendelenburg test, and then you allow a lot of semi-barbarians to tell you, you have to conquer the world, but you can't have the woman you want, the artificial lung, and the dive bomber. You're monsters, or you pander to monsters. I know I'm being unreasonable. What good is reason in a world like this? There you sit, watching your wife pack and saying nothing. Walls have ears, is that it? You people say nothing. One lot listens while the other keeps silent. Well, to hell with that! I'm to keep silent, too. If I loved you, I'd keep silent. I truly do love you. Now, Henry, those underclothes. They're suggestive. I'll need them. I'm 36, that's not too late. But I can't do too much more experimenting. You know, the next time I settle in a country, things can't be like this. The next man I get has to be allowed to keep me. And don't tell me you'll send me money. You know you won't be allowed. And you're not to pretend this is just a matter of 3 weeks either. You and I both know this is going to last rather longer than 3 weeks. So don't tell me, after all, it's only a matter of 2 or 3 weeks. As you hand me the fur coat, I shan't need till winter. And let's not talk about disasters. Let's talk about disgrace.
Doing tidying up?
No.
Are you packing?
I want to go away.
You talk- talking about?
Well, we talked about the possibility of my going away for a bit. It's no longer very pleasant here.
That's a lot of nonsense.
You want me to stay then?
Where are you thinking of going?
Amsterdam, just away.
Got nobody there?
No.
Why don't you wish to stay here? There's absolutely no need for you to go, so far as I'm concerned.
No.
You know, I haven't changed. You do, don't you, Judith?
Yes.
And does nothing else makes you want to go?
You know that.
Well, it might not be such a bad idea, I suppose. You need a breather. It's stifling in this place. I'll come and collect you. As soon as I get across the frontier, even if it's only for 2 days, I'll start feeling better.
Yes. Why don't you do that?
Things can't go on like this all that much longer. Something's bound to change. The whole business will die down again like an inflammation. It's a disaster. It really is.
Mm, definitely. Did you run into Shulk?
Yeah. Yes. Just on the stairs. I think he's begun to be sorry about the way they dropped us. He was quite embarrassed. In the long run, they can't completely sit on filthy intellectuals like us. And they won't be able to run a war with a lot of spineless wrecks. People aren't all that standoffish if you face up to them squarely. What time are you off, then?
9:15.
Where am I to send money to?
Let's say Amsterdam. Mr. Stant's main post office.
I see they give me a special permit. Good God, I can't send my wife off with 10 marks a month. It's all a lousy business.
It'll do you good if you can come and collect me.
To read a paper with something in it for once.
I rang Gertrude. She's to see you're all right.
Quite unnecessary.
Do you mind handing me my fur coat?
After all, it's only
any time away from aggravation, do you understand that? What is your problem? You're 30 fucking years old, dear. When are you going to grow up? Everything you do turns stupid.
I don't know what happened. I was just...
Yeah, don't get too comfortable because you've got like 5 minutes, haven't you?
I would have gone to Mary Ann's, but she hates me.
I piss everybody off, that's why.
I don't mean to. Jesus Christ, I don't think about pissing people off.
Look, Finny comes home and finds you in my ass is grass.
If Jerry catches me out there, he'll kill me, Sandra!
Why? What dumb fucking thing did you do this time? Come on, let's do it.
I mean, I'm trying. Even though you don't believe me, I'm trying to be normal like everyone else. Can I have a cupcake? Downstairs, hair pulled back, woken up in the middle of the night for hard sex, assaulted in a restaurant, pushed out of a car.
It's not like the last night.
No, he hit me this morning at breakfast. Kiss. Well, he's a bra fanatic, and last night we had this.
He wears bras.
No, he makes me wear them. I'm having sex, and last
night. But why am I talking to you? You're driving me crazy, Dolores. Will you just ease up and go? I mean it.
What if he's out there waiting for me?
Go to the police.
I... Forget the cop shit, alright? They don't do anything. This is what I'm probably going to tell him. Check out the bite marks on my bra.
So do you really went to Kathy's?
I pounded and I pounded. There is no one home.
They saw you coming in and call.
Well, just as well. Her being with wallpaper makes me feel like I'm 15 again. I get all sad.
Dolores, I used to beat you up twice a day when you were 15.
As soon as I got tits, she went crazy.
He was 10, right?
What?
No, I'm just trying to get things straight.
You're not really going to kick me out, are you?
Dolores, I things to get involved with are right above my head. And I mean, he's hit you, and you've got to sort it out with him. And this bra thing, I mean, we all get involved with these strange things, but you do it. And when you do it enough, it's not strange anymore. Vinny and I have been getting on good lately because we just walk around and don't talk and Fridays he gets what he wants.
I don't want that. I want more than that. I want no talking and watching TV. If I wanted that, I would have stayed married to Frankie.
Frankie is forgetting people for his hand and couldn't even talk straight.
When I met Jerry, I was down in the pits. Family, no kids, 30 years old, and I'm fucking bars dying for someone to touch my fucking hand. I look at these guys and I think, please God, let him say something nice to me. Because I'm the one for him. I pray that he could see it in my eyes. But too often nothing like that ever happened. And then I was at 4D's downtown one night, feeling pretty fucking low. Thinking about death more and more. And then out of nowhere, this voice says, how'd you like to see the sunrise in Montreal? And I look over, and I see Jerry looking at me. Well, one eye was, the other one was pointed at the ceiling. Not too bad, you know? I could put up with a bum eye. Because I stopped thinking about my family, and I didn't think about my 3 abortions. Do you know I have an 8-year-old? 9 next June. And a 5-year-old. Oh, shit. Can you imagine me with kids?
No.
Do you hate them too? Then help me. Help me get through this, Sandra.
What? What do you want me to do?
What? Put you in the cellar. Hide you in the closet. Do you want to sleep under little Vinny's bed with Bert and Andrew? I need help, Sandra.
Sandra,
I need support. I'm good. Why are everyone's down on me? Because I don't like getting beat up.
Okay, wait a minute.
Fucking hell, everyone. I should have fucking killed myself. You know, you're assholes. I'm supposed to put up with it because Ma did.
Who says that?
I mean, Frankie, he pushed me around and I knew he wasn't going anywhere, but Jerry is just mean. I had my fucking face stepped on. And some days, he'd take a couple of uppers and go at me for 2 days straight, waving his gun in front of my face. I would like to see you or Kathy or fucking Marianne put up with that shit. I'm good, Sandra, I'm good, deep down in here. And that time at the mall, when I saw you and Marianne, I wanted to run up and give you a hug. Because you're my sisters. But man, oh man, the vibe's coming out of you two for me to keep my distance.
I don't remember.
We didn't even show any affection during
Stop.
That.
Stop!
That's how fucked up we are. We just all stayed in our own separate spaces with our own separate memories of him. I knew everyone was buzzing about me, but kept it together because I'm the oldest. And then at that party, at Aunt Betty's afterwards, I gave Mum a present and she threw it across the fucking room at me.
It was that stupid. And it was the wrong time for it. That book.
My mother and myself.
It was done.
Yeah, well, I thought it was time. I thought with Dad out of the way, we could patch things up.
With you and Maya, it's going to take some time. And I don't know why.
It's not what my shrink says.
What's your shrink? Where'd you get the money to your shrink?
It's only $1 a week. Well, maybe you can afford. Like welfare shrinks. That clinic on Cranston Street.
Wait, what's your
Because she's only there Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Is Jerry going to go there?
Fuck you. Fuck you prick.
Wait a minute. What does the shrink say you should do by him?
That I should confront him more and let him know the problems that I have with him.
That's it.
What do you want for a buck?
Have you talked to Jerry?
If you've got a problem with Minnie, say he does something disgusting that pisses you off, what do you do, Sandra? Do you say, gee, Min, looking kind of ugly in your boxer shorts and you're getting kind of fat. I think it's kind of gross that you've got tits now and how do you think I feel being on the bottom all the time?
Wait,
what do you do, Sandra, if you've got a problem with the big fin, huh? How do you let him know you've got an issue? Do you shove his dinner plate at him a little harder than usual? Yeah, and disappears. Right.
Look, we don't have the same problems you do. The kids take up a lot of time and
yeah, not to mention chatting on the phone to Kathy and Marianne about Dolores.
Go. Get your stuff and leave out. Everyone deals with you. I'm stressful when it comes to that. Don't tell me just be quiet for it.
One footstep and then another. Could it be Vinny?
No way. Vinny clears his throat, then his mouth, then there's how Allergan size and pawns, and then he comes out. Listen, Dolores.
What do you want my hair?
Shit, Dolores!
You know, like the woman on Channel 6 has it.
You come here, mess up my day, get into some war stories, get into a few insults, and you want me to fix your hair for you?
Well, you said you would. At Christmas time, you promised me you would do this! there to help.
The dog. He used to go bullshit on the dog and sometimes for no reason just start belting and being mean. So I figured that the dog's the man's best friend because he doesn't say go fuck yourself after he gets hit. And time last year, I was driving from Vinny's mother's house. I stopped at a light. This motorcycle pulls up and I looked and there was this good looking guy on the bike. He was so close I could have grabbed his arm. And he turned around and looked at me with those eyes, great cheekbones he had, then winked and smiled, just like some fucking TV commercials. And I couldn't take my eyes off of him. I tried because I knew I was going on to him, but I couldn't. And then I felt my hair being pulled against the fucking seat. Next thing I knew, I was being punched in the face, not slapped. Same way he used to hit the dog. And I could hear the dog just like way off in the distance. Something went away with that guy. What am I talking about? What the fuck is going on? This all sounds so stupid now, said and everything. I was mad because I thought maybe he would be mad at me and the words. I'll take care of him. I'll take care of him.
Samuel.
I mean, you're my sister, damn it. If we can't even then, what's the fucking point?
Have you got any aspirin?
What?
Aspirin, you got me?
Yeah, I've got aspirin, but listen, do you want some money? I have some money. I've saved some money for something special someday, and I want you to have it.
I don't want any money, Samuel. Aspirin would be good.
Too many times and he wouldn't let me out of his sight.
Tell me you didn't.
I did. He was sitting at the kitchen table reading the paper and I had his gun that I took out of his coat pocket and I aimed it at the picture of Bush on the front page. I shot that picture and he went flying back onto the floor and he was laughing. I ran out of there, but I heard him say, "I can kill you now." And so I ran. I ran down the middle of Homewood Street, and I could hear him in the car behind beeping on the horn, and I could see people. I could see people getting the paper and going to church. And so I cut through the Kentucky Fried Chicken, and I ran up Whitmarsh Street and got on the bus and went to Kathy's. But she wasn't there, so I came here.
Shut up, Mary Ann, because I'm bringing her.
What are you doing?
I'm holding on to Lynn.
Oh. Why?
I don't know. I'm in pain. Aren't I allowed to hold on to my brother's leg if I'm in pain?
Of course you are, Tori. It just seems weird. What were they doing, torturing you?
Yeah.
Did it hurt?
If it didn't hurt, Michael, it wouldn't be torture, would it?
No, I suppose.
Did yours hurt?
Did my what hurt?
Then they tortured you.
Oh, they didn't torture me.
What?
No, the man said he was going to torture me, but I thought, no way, boy, that hurt. So I just told him whatever he wanted to hear, and he was fine then.
But I heard you scream.
Yeah, he asked me to scream. He said I did it really good.
Are you telling me he just told you what to say and you agreed to it?
Yeah.
Swear to me on your life that you did not kill those three kids.
I swear to you on my life I did not kill those three kids.
Did you sign anything?
No. You know I can't sign nothing. then maybe we can still get out of this. Get out of what? Get out of being executed for killing three children, Michael.
Oh, get out of being executed for killing three children. That'd be good. How?
Well, the only thing they've got against this is what you said and the stuff they said they found in the house.
What stuff?
They had this box full of these little toes and... Hang on. They said they were toes. They could have been anything. They didn't really look like toes. Oh, shit. And they said they tortured you too. Are you sure they didn't touch you?
No.
I mean, his hands were all covered with blood.
He gave me a ham sandwich.
Why are we being so stupid?
Why?
Why are we believing everything that they're telling us?
Why?
This is just like storytelling.
Yeah, I know.
A man comes into a room and says your mother's dead. Yeah?
Yeah. I know my mother's dead.
No, I know, but like in a story. A man comes into a room and says to another man, your mother's dead. What do we know? Do we know that the other man's mother is dead?
Yes.
No, we don't.
No, we don't.
All we know is that a man has come into a room and said to another man, your mother is dead. That is all we know. A man comes into a room and says, your brother has just confessed to the killing of three children and we found one of the kid's toes in a box in your house. What do we know?
Oh, I get it.
Do we know that the brother has killed three children?
No.
No, we don't. Do we know that the brother has confessed to killing three children?
No.
No, we don't. Do we know that they found out one of the kid's toes in a box in the house? No, we don't. Do we know that... Oh, my God.
What?
We don't know that there were any kids killed at all.
It was in the papers.
Who runs the papers?
The police. Oh! I get it! You're quite clever!
A writer in a totalitarian state is interrogated about the gruesome content of his short stories and their similarities to a number of child murders that are happening in his town. A number of child murders that aren't actually happening at all. Ooh, if I had a pen now, I could make a decent story out of this. They weren't going to execute us in an hour. Michael, whatever they do to you, no matter what, you don't sign anything. No matter what they do to you, you don't sign anything. You got it?
Whatever they do to me, I don't sign anything. No matter what they do to me, I don't sign anything. Can I sign your name?
Especially don't sign my name.
I killed a load of kids, son. Turing, Turing.
I'm gonna beat the shit out of you. Come here.
Go.
No, come here. Shit. Go. Out. Michael. Oh, Jesus.
Sorry, Turing.
All right, Michael. We're gonna be all right. We're gonna get out of this.
We just stick together.
Yeah, my ass is really itchy today. I don't know why. Have you got any of that powder left?
No, you used it all.
Oh, tell me a story, Katrine. It'll take my mind off it.
What story do you want?
A little green pig?
No, that's just silly.
No, it's not just silly, it's good.
Oh, no. I'll do another one. What'll I do?
Do the Pillow Man.
I like the Pillow Man. That's from a long time ago, isn't it? Alright, let me see, how does it start? Once upon a time, there was a man who did not look like normal men. He was about 9 feet tall, and he was all made up of these fluffy pink pillows. His arms were pillows, and his legs were pillows, and his body was a pillow, and even his head was a pillow, a big round pillow.
A circular pillow.
It's the same thing.
But I prefer a circular pillow.
His head was a circular pillow. And on his head, he had two button eyes and a big smiley mouth, which was always smiling, so you could see his teeth, which were also pillows. Little white pillows.
Pillows, yeah. Do your mouth smiley like the Pillow Man's is.
Anyway, the Pillow Man. He had to look like this. He had to look soft and safe because of his job. Because his job was a very sad and very difficult one.
Oh, here it comes.
You see, whenever a man or a lady was very, very sad, and they just wanted to end it all, they wanted to take their own lives and take all the pain away, well, just as they were about to do it, the Pillow Man, he would go to them, and he'd sit with them, and he'd gently hold them, and he'd say, "Hold on a minute." And time would slow strangely, and as time slowed, the Pillow Man would go back in time to when that man or that lady was just a little boy or a little girl, back to when the life of pain they were to lead hadn't quite yet begun. The Pillow Man's job was very, very sad, because the Pillow Man's job was to give that little boy or that little girl to commit suicide, and so avoid all the years of pain that would just end up in the same place anyway, facing a shotgun, or facing an oven, or facing a lake. See, the Pillow Man, he would do it in a special way. Because I'm sure you would say, "I've never heard of a small child committing suicide." The Pillow Man was clever, and he'd get them to do it in a way that looked just like a tragic accident. He'd show them the bottle of pills that looked just like candies. He'd show them the place on the river where the ice was too thin. See, mommies and daddies always find it easier to come to terms with a 5-year-old lost in a tragic accident than they do with a 5-year-old who's seen how shitty life is and has taken action to avoid it. See, when the Pillow Man was successful in his work, a little child would die horrifically. When the Pillow Man was unsuccessful, a little child would have a horrific life, grow into an adult who would also lead a horrific life, and then die horrifically. So the Pillow Man, as big as he was, and as fluffy as he was, he'd just go around crying all day long. I mean, his house would just be puddles everywhere. So he decided to do one final job, and that would be it. So he went to this place that he remembered, this pretty place by a stream that he remembered from a time before. And he brought along a little can of gasoline with him, and he went underneath this weeping willow tree, and he sat down, and he waited a while. Pretty soon, your little footsteps closer and closer and closer, and then the branches of the willow tree parted, and it wasn't a little boy at all, but a little pillow boy. And the Pillow Man, he told the pillow boy about his sad job and the dead kids and all that kind of stuff, and the pillow boy, he understood instantly, because he was a happy little fella, and all he ever wanted to do was to be able to help people. So the pillow boy poured the can of gasoline all over himself, and the Pillow Man said, "Thank you," through his goofy tears. And the Pillow Boy said, "That's all right." And the Pillow Boy struck a match. And the Pillow Man sat there, watching it burn. And through his gloopy tears, the last thing that he saw, as he slowly started to fade away, was the Pillow Boy's happy, smiley mouth slowly melting into nothingness. And that was the last thing that he saw. The last thing that he heard wasn't something that he even contemplated. The last thing that he heard were the screams of the 100,000 children he had helped to commit suicide coming back to life and going on to lead the sad, wretched lives that were destined to them, because he hadn't been around to prevent them. Right on up to the sad screams of their self-inflicted deaths, which this time, of course, would be conducted entirely alone.
So the Pillow Man just faded away.
Yeah, he just faded away like he never existed.
Into the air.
Into the air, into wherever.
Into heaven.
No, into wherever.
I like the Pillow Man. He's my favorite.
Yeah. It's a bit downbeat, I'll admit. Is your itchy ass any better now?
Oh, what's till you reminded me? But I still can't figure it out.
Figure out what? Figure out the pillow man?
No, I thought I'd hit it really well.
Hitting what really well?
The box with the little boy's toes in it. I thought I hit it really well in the Christmas tree pot in the attic, because I knew we wouldn't be getting the Christmas tree pot out again for ages, like till Christmas. They must have used sniffer dogs or something.
You just told me you didn't touch those kids. You lied to me.
No, I didn't. I just said the man came in and said he would torture me unless I said I killed those kids. So I said I killed those kids. That doesn't mean I didn't kill those kids. I did kill those kids.
You swore to me on your life that you didn't kill those kids!
Oh, yeah. See, with that one, the swear to me on your life I didn't kill those three kids, yeah, I was kind of playing a trick on you, Victorine. Sorry. I knew it was wrong, but it was very interesting.
What did you do it for?
You know, because you told me to.
Because I what?
Because you told me to.
I remember telling you to do your homework on time. I remember telling you to brush your teeth every night.
I do brush my teeth every night.
I do not remember telling you to go take a bunch of kids and go butcher them.
Well, I wouldn't have done anything if you hadn't told me, so don't you act all the innocent. I mean, every story you tell me something horrible happens to somebody, I was just testing out how far-fetched they were. Because I always thought some of them were a bit far-fetched. You know what? They ain't all that far-fetched.
Are you telling me you don't know that if you chop the toes off of a little boy or shove razors down the throat of a little girl, you don't know that they're gonna die?
Well, I know now. Well, the torture man certainly seemed to be on my side. He seemed to agree it was all your fault. Well, mostly your fault.
What did you tell him?
Just the truth.
Which particular truth, Michael?
Just that, you know, all the things I did to all the kids, I got from the stories you wrote and read out to me.
You said that to the policeman?
Just the truth.
That's not the truth, Michael!
Yes, it is.
No, it isn't!
Well, did you write some stories with children getting murdered in them?
Yes, but...
Well, did you read them out to me?
Yes!
Well, did I go out and murder a bunch of children? Yes, I did is the answer to that one. So I don't see how that is and the truth comes into it. I mean, you're my brother and I love you, but, you know, you just spent 20 minutes telling me a story about a guy, his main thing in life is to get a bunch of little kids to, at minimum, set themselves on fire. So, you know, and he's the hero. And I'm not criticizing. He's a very good character. He's a very, very good character. He reminds me a lot of me.
How does he remind you?
Getting little children to die, all that.
The Pillow Man never killed anybody, Michael. And all the children that were going to die were going to lead horrible lives anyway.
You're right. All children are going to lead horrible lives. You may as well save them the hassle.
Not all children are going to lead horrible lives!
Did you lead a horrible life since you was a child? Yes. Did I lead a horrible life since I was a child? Yes. That's 2 out of 2 for start.
Pillow Man was a thoughtful, decent man who hated what he was doing. You are the opposite in every respect!
Oh, you know I'm no good at opposites, but I think I know what you're trying to say. Thank you. The Pillow Man's a good story, Katerin. It's one of your best. You know, I think you're going to be a famous writer someday. I can see it.
They are going to execute us in an hour.
Oh yeah, well I guess you aren't going to be a famous writer then.
They're going to destroy everything now. They're going to destroy us. They're going to destroy my stories. They're going to destroy everything.
Well, I think it's us you should be worried about, Katerina, not your stories.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, they're just paper.
They're just what?
And they're just paper.
They came to me right now and said, we're going to burn 2 out of 3 of you. You, your brother, or your stories. I'd have them burn you first. I'd have them burn me second, and I'd have it be the stories that they saved!
You just banged my head on the floor.
I noticed that.
You just banged my head on the floor.
I said I noticed that!
You're just like mom and dad.
Oh, say that again!
You're just like mom and dad hitting me and shouting at me.
I'm just like mom and dad. Let me see, Michael. Let me work this out.
Don't start that.
No, no. Mom and dad kept their firstborn son in a room where they tortured him for 7 years straight. And you made a little boy bleed to death, made a little girl choke to death, and did God knows what else to a third little girl. But you're not like mom and dad. And I slammed a fucking dimwit's head on the floor once, and I am like mom and dad.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
I see where you're coming from, Michael. I see your logic.
I'm not like them. I didn't want to hurt anybody. I was just doing your stories.
What did you do to the third girl?
No, I'm not telling you now. You hurt my feelings and you hurt my head.
You'll tell quick enough when they get a hold of you.
I can take it.
Not like this you can.
You don't know what I can take.
I don't suppose I don't.
You know, when I was in here listening to you screaming next door, I thought this must have kind of been what it was like for you all these years. But let me tell you, it's easier on this side.
I know it is.
You only had it for an hour and you came in whining your snotty head off. Try it for a lifetime.
That doesn't excuse anything.
It excuses who you murdered. Why shouldn't it excuse who I murdered?
I murdered 2 people who tortured an innocent child for 7 years. You murdered 3 children who hadn't tortured anyone for 8 years. There is a difference.
As far as you know, they hadn't tortured anybody. The razor blade girl seemed like a little shit. I bet she at least did ants.
What did you do to the third girl, Michael? I just need to know. Was she like in a story too? Which story?
You're gonna be mad.
I am not going to be mad.
She's like a little Jesus. A little Jesus.
On that one.
It's a good story. You're a good writer, Katrin. Oh. Don't let anybody tell you different.
Where did you leave her?
Is that where you buried mom and dad after wishing well? Don't cry, Kat. It'll be alright.
How will it be alright?
I don't know. It's just something you say at a time like this, isn't it? It'll be alright?
Oh. Will they execute us together or separate? I hope it's together. I wouldn't want to be on my own.
I haven't done anything!
Well, don't start that, or you get on my nerves again! And even if they don't execute us together, they're bound to bury us together, and at least we'll be together in heaven no matter what happens.
And which particular heaven is this that you're going to, Michael?
Child killer heaven? No! Not child killer heaven, smartass! Regular heaven like in the movies!
You want to know where you're going when you die?
Where? And don't say something mean just because you're mad at me.
You're gonna go to a little room in a little house, in a little forest. For the rest of all time, you're going to be looked after by a person called Mom and a person called Dad. And they are going to look after you in the same way that they always looked after you. Except this time, I'm not going to be around to rescue you, because I ain't going to the same place where you're going, because I never butchered any fucking little kids!
That is just the most meanest thing I have ever heard anybody say to any other person, and I am never going to speak to you again, ever!
Good.
The meanest thing I ever heard! And I told you not to say anything mean. I said, don't say anything mean, and what did you do? What did you do? You said something mean!
I used to love you so much.
What do you mean, you used to? Well, that's an the even meaner thing to say than the other mean thing you said. And the other mean thing was the meanest thing I ever heard. Jesus!
Let's just sit here in silence, okay?
I'm trying to sit here in silence. You keep saying mean stuff, don't ya? Don't ya, I said? Oh, is this the sitting here in silence part? Okay. Except I've got another bone to pick with you. A bone which is all about a stupid little story called The Writer and the Writer's Brother, the story was called, which was the biggest pile of crap I ever read. That I died and Mom and Dad lived. That's a stupid ending.
Now I'm getting literary advice from Jack the fucking Ripper.
Why didn't you make it a happy ending like it was in real life?
There are no happy endings in real life.
Well, my story was a happy ending. You came in, you rescued me, and you killed Mom and Dad. That's a happy ending. Me dead and left to rot, that would not be a happy ending.
That was a happy ending.
What, that I am dead and left to rot?
What was in your hand when you died? A story. A story that was better than any of my stories. See? The writer and the writer's brother. You were the writer, I was the writer's brother. That made it a happy ending for you.
But I was dead.
This isn't about being or not being dead, Michael. It's about what you leave behind.
I don't get it.
Right at this moment, I don't care if they kill me. I don't care. But they are not going to kill my stories. They are not going to kill my stories. They're all I've got.
You've got me.
Why did it have to be the little Jesus, though?
Oh, Katurian, when stone is done, it can't be undone. I'm getting a bit sleepy now, so I'm going to go to bed. If I could just get my mind off my ass, which is still itchy like crazy, even though I haven't even mentioned it.
You're gonna go to sleep.
Yeah.
They're coming back to torture and execute us any minute.
Exactly, so it might be the last sleep we get for a while. Tyrion.
What?
Tell me a story. Tell me the one about the little green pig and I'll forgive you.
Forgive me for what?
Forgive you for saying all those mean things about Mom and Dad being in charge of me till the end of time in the little forest and no one would ever come rescue me?
Once upon a time, there was a pig who was different from all the other pigs around. See, the little pig, he liked being green. Not that he didn't like the color of normal pigs. He thought pink was a nice color, too. But what he liked about being green was it made him a little bit different, a little bit peculiar. The other pigs, they didn't like him being green. They were jealous, and they bullied him, and made his life a misery. It got on the nerves of the farmers, too, and they thought, we've got to do something about this. So what they did was, one night, when all the pigs lay sleeping out in the open fields, they crept out, they snatched up the little green pig, and took him back to the barn. And the little green pig was squealing and squealing, and all the other pigs were just laughing at him. When the farmers got the little green pig to the barn, what they did was, they opened up this big pot of this very special pink paint, and they dumped in it from head to toe until he was completely covered and not a single patch of green was left. And then they held him down until he dried. And what was special about this pink paint was, it could never be washed off, and it could never be painted over. Never be washed off, and it could never be painted over. The little green pig said,
"Oh, please, God. Don't let them make me like all the rest. I'm happy being a little bit peculiar.
I'm happy being a little bit peculiar.
But it was too late. The paint was dry, and the farmers set him free out into the open fields. And as he walked by all the other pigs, they were laughing at him as he passed and went and sat down on his favorite little patch of grass. And he couldn't understand why God hadn't answered his prayers. So he cried himself to sleep. Even the 1,000 tears he cried couldn't wash off the special paint because
it can never be washed off, it can never be painted over.
Exactly. So he went to sleep. But that night, as all the pigs were sleeping out in the open fields, these strange storm clouds started to gather. It began to rain. Slowly at first, but getting heavier and heavier and heavier. This was no ordinary rain. This was a very special green rain, almost as thick as paint. More than that, there was something else special about it. It could never be washed off, and it could never be painted over. It could never be washed off. Around and they saw that every single one of them had turned bright green. Every single one except the old little green pig, who was now a little pink pig, upon whom the strange rain had washed right off because of the strange, unpaint-overable paint the farmers covered him in earlier. Unpaint-overable. And the little pig smiled, and he thanked God, because he knew that he was, and he always would be, just a little bit peculiar. You like that one, don't you, Michael? You used to like that one. No razor blades in it. No little toes. It's nice. Maybe you should have acted that one out. It's not your fault, Michael. It's not your fault. Screw trees were made. I'll tell you all soon. Detectives! Detectives! I would like to make a confession as to my part in the murder of 6 people. I have one condition. It involves my stories.
chair taken?
Excuse me?
Is this taken?
Yes, it is.
Oh, sorry.
Sure thing.
Excuse me, is this chair taken?
Excuse me?
Is this taken?
No, but I'm expecting somebody in a minute.
Oh, thanks anyway.
Sure thing.
Is he taken?
No, but I'm expecting.
Mind if I sit here until he or it comes?
I do seem to be pretty late.
You never know, he might be turning down.
Sorry. Nice try, though.
Yeah. Sure thing. Excuse me, is this chair taken?
No, it's not.
Mind if I sit here?
Yes, I would.
Is this chair taken?
No, it's not.
Have I sit here?
Yeah,
thanks. Every place else seems to be taken. It's a great place.
Mm-hmm.
What's the book?
I just wanted to read in quiet if you don't mind.
Sure thing. Every place else seems to be taken.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great place for reading.
Yes, I like it.
What's the book?
The Sound of Fury.
Oh, Hemingway. What's the book?
Sound of Fury.
Oh, Faulkner.
Oh, you read it?
Not actually. I've sure read a lot about it, though. It's supposed to be great.
It is great.
Yeah, I hear it's great. Waiter! What's the book?
Sound of Fury.
Oh, Faulkner.
Have you read it?
I'm a Mets fan myself.
Have you read it?
Yeah, I read it in college.
Oh, where was college?
I went to Oral Roberts University.
Where was college?
Actually, I was lying. I never really went to college. I just liked to party.
Where was college?
It was Harvard.
Did you like Harvard?
I spent a whole winter reading him once.
I just started.
I was so excited after the first 10 pages. I went out and bought everything else he wrote. It's one of the greatest reading experiences of my life. Oh, that incredible psychological understanding in page after page of gorgeous prose. His profound grasp of the mystery of time and human. Oh, the smells of the earth. What do you think?
I think it's pretty boring.
What's the book?
Sound of Fury.
Oh, Faulkner.
Do you like Faulkner?
I love Faulkner.
He's incredible.
I spent a whole winter reading him once.
I was so excited after the first 10 pages. I went out and bought everything else he wrote.
All that incredible psychological understanding.
And the prose is so gorgeous.
And the way he's grasped the mystery of time.
And human existence. I can't believe I waited this long to read him.
You never know. You might not have liked him before.
That's true.
You have to hit these things at the right moment or else it's no good.
That's happened to me.
It's all in the timing. My name's Bill, by the way.
I'm Betty.
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, I thought reading Faulkner was a great experience.
Yes.
Sounded fury.
Onwards and upwards.
Waiter! You have to hit these things at the right moment or else it's no good.
That's happened to me.
It's all in the timing. My name's Bill, by the way.
I'm Betty.
Hi.
Hi.
So do you... in here a lot?
Actually, I'm just in town for 2 days from Pakistan.
Pakistan. My name's Bill, by the way.
I'm Betty.
Hi.
Hi.
Do you come in here a lot?
Once in a while, do you?
No, not so much anymore. Not as much as I used to before my nervous breakdown. Do you come in here a lot?
Why are you asking?
Just interested.
Are you really interested, or are you just trying to pick me up?
No, I'm really interested.
Why would you be interested if I come here a lot?
Just getting acquainted?
Maybe you're only making small talk long enough to ask me back to your place to listen to some music. Or because you've just rented this really great tape for your VCR. Or because you have some terrific, unknown Django Reinhardt record. Only all you really want to do is fuck. Which you won't do very well. After which, he'll go into the bathroom and pee very loudly. How did you get yourself a beer without asking me if I'd like anything? Then you'll proceed to lie down next to me and tell me, you've got a girlfriend named Stephanie who's in medical school in Belgium for a year, and you've been involved with her off and on in what you call a very intricate relationship for the past 7 years, none of which interests me, mister.
Okay. So you come in here a lot?
Almost every other day.
I come in here quite often. I don't remember seeing you.
Must be on different schedules.
Misconnections.
Yep, different time zones.
It's amazing how you can live right next door to someone in this town and never even know it.
I know.
City life.
Crazy.
We probably pass each other on the street every day, right in front of this place, probably.
Yeah.
Waiters here sure seem to be on different time zones. I can't seem to locate one anywhere. So, what are you?
I beg your pardon.
Nothing. Sorry.
We must be on different schedules.
Misconnections.
Yes, different time zones.
It's amazing how you can live next door to someone in this town and never even know it.
I know.
City life.
Crazy.
So you weren't waiting for someone when I came in here, were you?
Actually, I was.
Boyfriend?
Sort of.
It's a sort of boyfriend.
My husband.
Aha. So you weren't waiting for someone when I came in here, were you?
Actually, I was.
Boyfriend?
Sort of.
It's a sort of boyfriend.
We were meeting to break up.
Aww. So, what's a sort of boyfriend?
My lover. Here she comes, right now.
You weren't waiting for someone when I came in here, were you?
No, just reading.
Sort of a sad occupation for a Friday night, isn't it? Reading here all by yourself?
You think so?
Well, sure. I mean, what's a good-looking woman like you doing that alone on a Friday night?
Trying to stay away from lines like that.
You weren't waiting for someone when I came in here, were you?
No, just reading.
Sort of a sad occupation for a Friday night, isn't it? Were you here all by yourself?
I guess it is in a way.
Well, sure. What's a good-looking woman like you doing out alone on a Friday night? No offense, but...
I'm out alone on a Friday night for the first time in a very long time.
Oh.
You see, I just recently ended a relationship of rather long standing.
I'm sorry. Well, you know, since reading by yourself is such a sad occupation for a Friday night, would you like to go elsewhere and do something else? I think I was hinting to do anyway.
Thanks anyway.
Big chance like Bob catches Brett Little's long sentence is getting pretty tired.
I don't think so.
Okay.
I appreciate the invitation.
Sure thing. You weren't waiting for someone when I came in here, were you?
No, I was just reading.
Well, that's sort of a sad occupation for a Friday night, isn't it? Reading here all by yourself?
I guess I was trying to think of it as existentially romantic. Cappuccino, great literature, great night.
That only works in Paris. We could hop the late plane to Paris, get on the Concorde, find a cafe.
No, I'm a little short on my fare tonight.
Alright, so am I.
Actually, I was headed to the movies after I finished this section. Would you like to come along, since you can't locate a waiter?
That's a really nice offer, but...
Girlfriend?
Two, actually. One's pregnant, and Stephanie will be
girlfriend?
No, I don't have a girlfriend. Not to me, the cash-ready bitch I dumped last night.
Girlfriend?
Sort of.
What's a sort of girlfriend?
My mother. I just ended a relationship actually.
Oh.
A rather long standing.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
This is my first night out alone in a long time. I feel a little bit at sea, to tell you the truth.
So, you didn't stop and talk to me because you're a Moonie or you have some weird political affiliation?
Nope. Straight down the ticket Republican. Straight down the ticket Democrat. Can I tell you something about politics? I'd like to think of myself as a citizen of the universe. I'm unaffiliated.
Literally? So am I.
Oh, my beliefs.
Labels are not important.
Labels are not important, exactly. I mean, take me for example. I mean, so what if I got a 2-point at a 3-point at a 4-point at college? Or that I didn't come from Pittsburgh? Cleveland? Westchester County?
Sure.
I believe a man is what he is. A person is what he is. A person is what they are.
I think so too.
So what if I admire Trotsky? So what if I once had a total body liposuction? I mean, so what if I don't have a penis? So what if I spent a year in the Peace Corps? I was acting on my convictions.
Sure.
You just can't hang a sign on a person.
Absolutely. I'll bet you're a Scorpio.
Listen, I was headed to the movies after I finished this section. Would you like to come along?
Sounds like fun. What's playing?
A couple of the really early Woody Allen movies.
Oh.
You don't like Woody Allen?
Well, sure, I like Woody Allen.
But you're not crazy about Woody Allen.
Well, those early ones kind of get on my nerves. So listen, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say that I was headed to the movies in a little while.
So was I.
The Woody Allen Festival?
Just up the street.
You like the early ones?
I think anybody who doesn't ought to be run off the planet.
How many times have you seen Bananas?
8 times.
12. Still interested?
Do you like Enderman's crumb cake?
I went out last night at 2 a.m. to get one. Did you have an Etch-a-Sketch as a child?
Yes! Do you like Brussels sprouts?
No. I think they're disgusting.
They are disgusting!
Do you still believe in marriage in spite of the current sentiments against it?
Yes.
And children?
3 of them.
2 girls and a boy.
Harvard, Vassar, and Brown.
Cherish me forever?
Yes.
You still want to go to the movies?
Sure thing.
Wait! Later!